Next, we welcome to the stage Mr. Ritvik Prabhu. He is a junior at Radnor High School. Ritvik will be exploring the relationship between philosophy and science through history and his own findings, and the possibility of a world where we know everything. Here is Ritvik Prabhu with Predictable Movements, a study of philosophy and science.
Looking at these three questions, they might not seem like they have much of a connection, really, but they do, and they all started when I began to think about predictability. These three questions are, what if we had all the available data in the world? Could we predict every outcome at that moment? And would philosophy still exist if we had all of this data? So it all began in my viewpoints class, and viewpoints is an integrated class of social studies and language arts. We were doing the transcendentalism unit, and we had to take our basic observations of our natural world and combine them into a larger idea. And I decided to do my essay about predictability, and I called it Predictable Motions. And the basic idea was, I saw in nature that there are a lot of patterns, and these patterns had a way of causing certain outcomes. So I said, are there certain variables which cause these outcomes, and if we found all of them, could we then predict every outcome? And I created an analogy. The snake and the mouse. So you have a snake, and you know that it gets hungry, and you know that it eats mice. So if you put a mouse in a cage with a snake, you know after a certain amount of time, the snake's gonna eat the mouse. And that's a really simplistic version of what I was trying to show, but it holds to be true. And so I was talking with my friends after I'd handed in the essay, and we talked, and they didn't really agree with me. And they didn't believe that, A, you could predict everything. And as we discussed, I don't know how it came up, but suddenly I was asked, would you believe that philosophy would still exist if we knew everything? And I didn't know how to answer that, so I decided to just stick with what I believe philosophy was, and my belief was that philosophy was explaining the unexplainable until science could come around to explaining it. And I created a graph in my head that looked something like this, and the basic idea was that blue is science and red is philosophy, and right where they, in between where they meet, that's sort of the frontier of knowledge. And so anything that's beyond in the red zone, we don't fully know yet, but we've created, you know, philosophies and thoughts to explain it. So I thought I was right, you know, I didn't agree with them. And I went home, sat down at the computer, did some research, and found I was wrong. And I was pretty wrong. There are two reasons why I was wrong. The first was that I found we can't actually predict every outcome. And the reason for that is based in physics and math. A man, a physicist named Gödel, he created three incompleteness theorems. And the first one was basically stated that in any system where you can do math of any kind, there are certain variables in F that you can't explain. And because you can't explain them, then you technically can't use them to predict other outcomes. And the basic idea of that is, I have a hand, and each finger on the hand is what we know. But in between each finger is what we don't know. And the sad thing about that is we don't know what we don't know, and so we can never truly figure that out. And the way to explain this and to come to a consensus, all the scientists, the global science community, met and decided that they would create the Copenhagen Interpretation. And the Copenhagen Interpretation uses Gödel's first incompleteness theorem and a couple other theorems, and it basically says that we don't know what we don't know, and we can't predict it because there's a certain degree of randomness. A way to explain that is concentric circles. Red is what we know right now, as of, and it's hardcore, like we know it. Blue is what we don't know, but we could technically find out if we find the variables. But then there's this green field around everything that we do and don't know, and that is what we can never find out because it's the degree of randomness. And of course, you know, scientists, they're going to disagree. And there are three scientists which created an argument to try to, they didn't fully agree with the quantum theory created by the Copenhagen Interpretation. And these three scientists were Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen. And their idea was that it wasn't targeting the fact that quantum theory was incorrect, they just believed that it was incomplete. They did agree with the what Copenhagen Interpretation had created, they just didn't think it was enough. And they use a lot of scientific jargon that I don't understand, but that's basically the main idea. However, Einstein took it a little bit farther. So he used the EPR argument to try to prove that quantum theory is incomplete because of these things called hidden variables. And hidden variables are basically just variables we don't know. And to explain that, so once again, red is what we do know, but then all around, instead of a blue field, it's just one green field of what we don't know, but we can find out. So Einstein was a determinist, which means that he believed God does not roll the dice. He thought that at the end point of human existence, we technically could figure out every single variable and predict every outcome. So, I mean, it's pretty neat agreeing with Einstein. The only downside was that it went against the full global scientific community. So to answer that question, could we predict every outcome? No, we cannot, as of now. And recently, funny thing, the EPR theorem might be incorrect because one of the main foundations of that theorem was that of electron entanglement, which means electrons can't affect other electrons far away. But scientists have recently observed that that actually does occur. So right now it's up in the air whether or not they were actually correct. So my second mistake was believing that science and philosophy are fundamentally different. Because the truth is, science is philosophy. Philosophy started at first and then science branched off of it, but they both come from the same roots. Philosophy is the idea of thinking. So a famous philosopher said, I think, therefore I am. And science started from the idea of natural philosophy, which is the idea that you can look into nature and that's where you get your ideas. The first major natural philosopher was Aristotle. And he didn't really use observation. He used his own ideas and what he had heard from other philosophers, but he did look into nature for those ideas. Then along came a man named Francis Bacon, and he was almost the creator of the empirical method and of science, because he said that I will never accept any truth unless I observe it myself. And that was incredibly important for the scientific community, because that meant now that you couldn't just take the word of someone from before, you had to prove it yourself. And so he was joined by another man, Rene Descartes. They had different ideologies, but they both were based in observation. So this is my new graph. I'm pretty proud of it, but it starts with right there, that's philosophy, which is blue, and that's science. You'll notice that x is the x intercepts in the graph are the time, and if you notice, philosophy is the only thing at the beginning of when we started truly thinking. And as time went on, right here where they intersect or they diverge, that is when Francis Bacon first created the idea of observation. And observation is a really important thing in science. It's actually on the Webster definition of science. It's a pretty important key thing. And so as they diverged, they didn't just completely separate and never met again. They do often intersect at several points, And they intersect depending on how abstract they are. So that's the y-axis. The z-axis, amount of knowledge, you don't really need to pay a whole lot of attention to, but that's just the idea that we're constantly learning things and science is constantly, or philosophy is constantly growing. But where they intersect, if the red overcomes the blue, that means that something that we thought was true in our heads, we were actually able to prove. And an example of that is the electron entanglement. And then where the blue intersects the red, that means that something that we thought we knew, like through observation or through science, was actually proven wrong through an abstract method. Many people think that physics and math is a science, but they really aren't, because they're based in just our minds. You don't really need to observe something to prove it's true. An example of that is the EPR theorem. Would philosophy still exist? Yes, because science is philosophy. Philosophy is thinking. During the Transcendentalism unit, we learned about a thinker named Ralph Waldo Emerson. And there was a quote that he said that really struck me. "Tomorrow, speak what tomorrow thinks in hard words again, though it contradict everything you said today." And I think this is really important. It doesn't really have a lot to do with the philosophy and science or with predictability, but it's the idea that it doesn't matter if you're wrong, because as long as you keep thinking, it doesn't matter that you're wrong today if you can accept what the truth is tomorrow. And science, as you've seen, moves so fast. Philosophers constantly have different ideas, but they keep thinking, and that's what I want you all to take away from today. Thank you.